This episode of the 10% Show is brought to you in part by Roscoe's, in the heart of the gay and lesbian community.
And in part by Outlines, the voice of Chicago's lesbian and gay community.
Hi, I'm John Ryan.
And I'm the Big Dog.
And this is the 10% Show. On this episode of the 10% Show, we have an exclusive interview with Kitty Tsui, lesbian poet and gold medal winning bodybuilder.
And you'll see Family Feud like you've never seen it before.
And Elizabeth Price talks with Pam McDonald about racism and how we can stop it. I'm here with the Big Doll surrounded by Bubblehead Dolls. These are the creations of Lee Kay. We're taping here in his studio tonight. On our first story on this episode of the 10% Show, Pam McDonald speaks with Elizabeth Price about dismantling racism in the gay and lesbian community.
What do you see as specific concerns that we need to deal with within our gay and lesbian community?
One of the things that happens with oppression is that it can make for greater comprehension when one is able to see one's own oppression and what the difficulties, what the struggles have been for you and your environment, then it's easier to translate that kind of a struggle to someone else's. In other words, to be more open to seeing exactly where the difficulties are and how you can help. I can remember some horror stories that occurred early on in my living here. I used to live around Washington Park on the south side. And some of the horrors that happened were not just, gay bashing coming from private individuals, but there was a lot of targeted abuse coming from government agencies and from the police department, things like that. I mean, I've seen some of the raw ugliness. There's a way that when you appreciate your own struggle, mm-hmm. It's easier to at least listen and hear what the other struggle is about, and unite, form some alliances, some mm-hmm. useful alliances, to combat both the heterosexism or homophobia mm-hmm. and racism.
I've heard from women of color in the past that it's not like the solution that can be handed to me. I need to work it out myself.
Precisely. I think that's what I was talking about before when I was saying I get torn. On the one hand, I want to say, here, this is what you need to do. Now, damn it, do it. But that doesn't go over to me. Most workshops. Actually, there are many workshops that I've seen, or several formulae that I've seen, which pretty much do that. You know, beat you mm-hmm. up and say, you poor, you rotten old person that you've been mm-hmm. racist all this time. My sense is that when people really do the work to have a sense of themselves, what damage is done, not just to people of color, but to themselves, they're mm-hmm. eager to make the change, and they do indeed come up with some solutions, some specific things they can do in mm-hmm. their lives.
Well, Elizabeth, you've said that one of the reasons you can keep your strength up in doing these workshops, which I imagine can be painful sometimes, educating people about racism, that you get your strength sometimes from other women of color. And I've heard that expressed before, that there's a need to sometimes be separate and be with other women of color and not have Caucasian women around. I don't want to infringe on anybody's space, you know, your right to do that. How do I know when that's the right time, when to approach you and when not to? If I see, for instance, the women of color tent at Michigan Women's Music Festival, I'm not mm-hmm. sure if you're familiar
yes,
with that.
It's important to, you know, to recognize that there are going to be those kinds of times when I want to pull back. Either I want to be by myself and or I want to be with other women of color, and I've got maybe four or five what I would call aces, you know, wonderful women. And when we get together, I don't want anything to interrupt that. What I'll do is to just say no. How do you know when it's a good time? You know, talk with your connection with the group, whoever that person is. And the relationship should be solid enough so that mm-hmm. she can say no and not have you, you know, disintegrate.
And I should be solid enough not to take it personally.
Well, just, I mean, you know, go and, you know, so if you have to cry about it, go and cry with somebody else, because that's the space that she needs. Mm-hmm. But there's another issue which comes up. By that I'm talking about internalized depression. Mm-hmm. Someone outside of the group can see it functioning and see it at play and can reach in and give a hand out. For example, there's a whole number that black women can sometimes do to each other where they, you know, call each other names or put each other down or something like that in fun. And sometimes if you call, you know, if that's happening with a friend of yours, if you called her attention to it, that is much more helpful than somebody sometimes in the group saying it, because mm-hmm. once it's really running and running high, mm-hmm. you don't see it. There needs to be a sense of pride in getting to where you've gotten with your struggles, as opposed to, in other words, alliances are stronger that way when there's pride mm-hmm. and respect that comes from both sides. So I think it's important that, I mean, I've seen some movements to bridge gaps, so that, you know, to at least, for example, include numbers in an organization which is largely Caucasian, you know, to include larger numbers of women of color, which is dangerous and scary and risky. Mm-hmm. That's one way. But in order to make the alliances firm, there has to be that kind of powerful getting together. Mm-hmm. When you start talking about racism or the effects that it's had on you, you mentioned earlier, it's painful. Mm-hmm. And it has to be done, if you're going to think about it, with somebody, it has to be safe to do so. And there has to be an element of trust. And that's not something that gets done overnight.
Have you seen Family Feud lately? Well, Roscoe's recently held a Family Feud match.
And it was a championship match between Razzmatazz, one of Chicago's most popular women's bars, and MSA, all benefiting the Metropolitan Sports Association of Chicago.
Welcome, everybody, to Roscoe's and the final round of Family Feud this evening. We have a championship. We have two great teams here. Our team on the left is going to be
Yeah.
Is everybody ready?
Are you ready?
Name something that a cat does that annoys you. Whoa, Alan's quick there to grab. Okay, Alan, that's your answer. Name something
that a cat does that annoys you? Purrs.
Yes! Yeah.
Purrs. I love it when my cat purrs for me. Don't I, honey? Sorry. Okay, let's see. Is cat a correct, is purr a correct answer?
Yes, yes!
Yes, it is a correct answer. Now let's see where it is on the board. Things are very delayed this evening, but that's all right. We'll work through this. Okay, let's see what number answer it is on the board, and then we'll see if we're going to give members of the Sports Association a chance to take it over. It's the number three answer. Yes, they accepted that. Jeff, let's see what a cat does that annoys you. It's more popular. You have two answers more popular than their answer.
Claws the furniture, scratches the couches and stuff.
Scratches the furniture, claws. Yes, good answer. Good answer. And that is going to be the number one answer, which means the members of the Sports Association have the choice of passing or playing.
We'll play.
They're going to play. Jeff says they're going to play. Great. So come on up here, next team member. Here we have Jack. Jack, what does the cat do that really annoys you?
Sheds its hair.
Sheds its hair. Good answer. I agree. Yeah. Correct answer. Yes, it is a correct answer. And it is the number five answer.
Yeah.
Sheds. Can you hold that? Thank you, Gwen. In the most recent survey, the top popular seven answers on the board. Name a place that makes you shiver just as the thought of being there. Do not say Roscoe's. That is an incorrect answer and not allowed.
Alaska.
Alaska. That is an incorrect answer, and I just want to read this question once again here to make sure it says, name a place that makes you shiver just at the thought of being there. Two-timing?
My parents' home.
Home. Yes, home is an incorrect answer. Okay, let's see, Jeff, let's see if you can come up with a better answer. I know one right off the top of my head that I think would just absolutely be perfect, but I'm not in the game. Come on up here, Jeff, let's find out what your answer would be. You have a clean slate there, so let's see if you can come up with one of them.
A graveyard.
A graveyard. Ooh, yes, it is a correct answer. Way to go. And let's see what an answer it is on the board. It is the number one answer, cemetery. All right, way to go. Okay, gentlemen, you have the opportunity to pass or play. The score this time, you are the underdogs once again with 300, and Razzmatazz has 420.
Well, pass.
They're going to pass it over here to Razzmatazz. Ooh, all right. So here we are back to Razzmatazz, and you're going to have to do this, guys. You're going to have to do this because these guys are dishing it over to you. Here's your diva. Thank you, Gwen.
Her mother's house scares me, too.
Her mother's house scares you, too.
Right.
Okay, Gwen, name something for me. Name a place that makes you shiver just at the thought of being there.
Wax Museum.
Wax Museum. Thank you very much. Oh, Gwen, I tell you, that stuff hasn't washed out of your hair yet either, has it? I think it permanently damaged your brain, too. Come on up here. Let's see if you can learn the Sports Association. Or Razzmatazz. You are one of the deadest audiences. I don't know if it was the corn story or what.
MSA.
Is that the same as PMS? Okay, answer please.
Court.
Court. Court is going to be their answer. Will they? No, they did not have it. And we do have the winners right here. Razzmatazz winning the championship Family Feud game here at Roscoe's. Way to go, ladies. All right, ready up. Give them a nice round of applause. You can wake up now because Razzmatazz won. And we certainly would like to thank this fine team over here for doing a very, very good job. But let's find out what the last two answers on the board would have been. The number six answer on the board was caves. Not bad, not bad. Number three answer is haunted house. Yes. See, you don't trust your own instincts. That's what you get. All right. Well, we have our winners right over here. Razzmatazz, way to go. Congratulations. And we also have the money that's going to go to your particular groups. And you get the hat, Gwen. Thank you all very much for joining us here this evening for the Family Feud Championship. Come back next Monday where we're going to be doing Jeopardy.
You know, I'm not on an NEA grant this year. So I have decided that I am going to write and talk as much about homoerotic activity as I possibly can.
On her latest tour, lesbian writer Kitty Tsui stopped at Women and Children First bookstore to read some of her poetry. Chicago writer Lola Lijong talked with Kitty after the reading.
Maybe we could start with you talking about how you came to the United States.
I came here with my family in 1968 from Hong Kong. I was actually born in Hong Kong. I went to England when I was 5 and lived there for 5 years. I went back to Hong Kong and then came here when I was 14.
Okay. When did you start identifying as a writer?
I began reading a lot as a child. And I would escape into adventure stories. And there was, at some point in my life, I realized that I could make up my own stories. You know, I had that power. And that's when I started writing. So I would say, you know, I was very early on in my teens when I started writing. In fact, I was writing for publication when I was 13 years old.
And you're widely anthologized as a writer,
mm-hmm.
and you also write for the lesbian and gay papers in San Francisco, is
right?
That true?
I write for the Bay Area Reporter. I'm a sports writer for the Bay Area Reporter. I write for Bay Times, which is also a gay newspaper. I write for the San Francisco Bay Guardian, which is an alternative paper, and I've been asked to start writing for The Advocate, mm-hmm. which is exciting because that's a national publication.
How did you get into bodybuilding?
I found that I really enjoyed the mental stimulation that it gave me. And I also liked the way that my body changed and the way my body looked. And so that was in 1982. And I also went to Gay Games 1 in San Francisco, and I saw the bodybuilding championships. And there were many, many men. And it was a packed theater. And of course, all the men cheered when all the men came out. And there were only 4 women contestants. But when the women came out, it was like the whole house came down. And it was incredible.
Don't call me sir. Call me strong. Call me woman who walks with a long stride. Woman with small breasts, big fists, walk with hands in pockets, standing tall, with a wide stance, broad shoulders, thick forearms, and wears a man's watch. Don't call me sir, call me strong. Call me shooting star, call me sea, call me wave upon wave, call me womb, call me woman.
As a woman and as an Asian woman, that I can challenge the old patriarchal stereotypes of what beauty is.
You've been coming out in many different ways and recently was on the cover of On Our Backs. What was the response from the San Francisco Asian lesbian community?
The myth is that Asian women are either very asexual, subservient beings, or that we're the highly sexed Susie Wong dragon ladies. And what I wanted to do in the photo spread is to show that an Asian woman can be beautiful in and of herself, and with all of her parts as a whole person. And the response was very critical. People felt like, a lot of Asian women felt like I shouldn't have taken off my clothes. I shouldn't have taken off my clothes for a lesbian magazine, that I was posing for pornography, which I don't, you know, agree with. So it started, you know, a lot of controversy.
Did that affect any of the readings that you were asked to do? Did you notice any difference?
More people came.
Okay.
Nice Chinese girls don't question, argue, or complain. Nice Chinese girls suffer in silence, endure with a smile, use chopsticks, and speak fluent Chinese. Nice Chinese girls don't make waves or talk back. Nice Chinese girls smile without showing their teeth, speak only when spoken to, and learn young to turn the other cheek. Nice Chinese girls don't stay out late or take the subway alone at night. Nice Chinese girls get straight A's, never tell lies, or say what they mean. I was born a nice Chinese girl. Good thing it was a phase I soon outgrew. My heritage as a nice Chinese girl forced me to rebel. I grew into a different breed of Chinese girl, visible, vocal, and proud to be a different breed of Chinese girl.
During your readings here in Chicago, I heard you mention a couple times that people recognized you more for being on the cover of On Our Backs, and the fact that it was over 6 months before someone even mentioned your poem in there, as compared to your 15 years of writing. To what do you attribute this?
Well, I think it was the first time that an Asian woman has been on the cover of On Our Backs. And I think people want to see more people of color on the cover. Well, I think that, you know, I've been writing for publication for, you know, 22 years. And as I said, it's difficult being a freelancer, and it's difficult writing for many, many anthologies. I don't think that I've really ever gotten any kind of recognition as a writer. I think it's really hard to be a person of color and to try to write and be included in mostly white anthologies.
If it's not bad enough, it's in the name, it's also in the face. One day, a woman instructor insisted I had been one of her guest speakers in a class. She was so sure of herself, she had me convinced it was during my alcohol days, when memory was gone. Jenny Lim was the speaker. It happens all the time. Orientals, so hard to tell apart. The same day, a woman stopped to wish me a good opening. I was not in a play or an art show. Zan Ji, Nancy Hom, and Stephanie Lowe had a three-woman show. That's not all. I've been called Willis Kim, Canyon Sam, Louise Lowe. It happens all the time. A newspaper woman thought I was Willis Kim for months. Willis Kim gets called Susan Kwong. Nellie Wong is made Nellie Kim, or not mentioned by name at all.
It's something that I've really had to struggle for. You know, name recognition. Whereas, say, being photographed for the magazine, I mean, I think it was a very striking spread. And so people just look at it and say, oh, yeah. You know, whereas with my writing, it's in so many different places. Mm. People don't make the connection.
And you've also been courageously coming out as an SM dyke. Do you want to make a statement about that?
Do I want to make a statement? Well, for me, it's just part of my sexual freedom and an aspect of my sexual expression. You know, it's not something that I do every time I make love, and it's not really anyone's business. I think it's important, though. I think it's important in this climate of censorship and sexual repression that we, you know, do come out and say, this is what I do, and I think it's okay. I think it's about choice. You know, it's not about abuse or wife battery. You know, it's consensual. It's about choice, and this is one of my choices.
Get into the water, she smiled. I'll feed you some strawberries. I did as I was told, finding it not altogether unpleasant to take orders from her. Jane fed me strawberries and vanilla ice cream with her fingers. I took the sweet berries in my mouth and her fingers in my tongue. Warm water enveloped me up to my shoulders. Heat rose from between my legs. Jane washed me all over with violet soap. She scrubbed my back and ass with a loofah, took my toes into her mouth and sucked on them. I moaned and squeezed my rubber ducks. She put her hands between my thighs and opened me up to her fingers. I felt the warmth of the water as I felt her pushing inside me. Aren't you glad you listened to Tina? She laughed. The candles were burning low. I got out of the tub slowly. Jane took a thick black towel and patted my body dry. She got down on her knees between my open legs and took me in her mouth. I'm so glad I listened to Tina Turner. Private dancer better be good to me.
I don't believe that anyone has the right to tell me what I can or cannot do, whether it's Jesse Helms or whether it's, you know, the our own lesbian police force that says, you know, or the lesbian morality police force that says, well, you know, this is politically correct and you can do this and this is not politically correct. Mm-hmm. Who are they to tell me what I can do?
For your many fans of your writing, can you say a little bit about what's coming out in the future, what they have to look forward to?
Sure. I just finished a manuscript of poetry and short stories, like my first book. It's called Nice Chinese Girls Don't. I'm also working on getting my first book republished. It's out of print right now, and that's called The Words of a Woman Who Breathes Fire. It came out in 1983. I'm working on a collection of short stories, of erotic short stories, called Breathless. So I'm almost through with that. And one of my long-term projects, which I will finally get to soon, is I'm working on a biography of my grandmother. Wow. Who's a very famous Cantonese opera singer. So those are some of the things that are coming. But in the near future, I will be, for those who enjoy my smile and face, I will be again be on the cover of On Our Backs, the November-December issue.
And for the last question, what advice or words of wisdom would you give aspiring Asian women writers today?
My advice is that you should pick up your pen, go to the computer, and just do it. Just get it out there. I think that there's a great need for more voices, and I think it's really important to write and just to get it out there. The more of us there are, the more powerful we'll be. So just go out and write.
Thank you, Kitty.
You're welcome.
This episode of the 10% Show is brought to you in part by Roscoe's, in the heart of the gay and lesbian community.
And in part by Outlines, the voice of Chicago's lesbian and gay community.